Hello students, welcome to the last lecture in the video series on biological nitrogen fixation. In today's class, we will be studying in detail on the genetic engineering of biological nitrogen fixation. So we have studied about the mechanism, the genetics, that is the genes involved, what are the different biochemical reactions that place in biological nitrogen fixation, but we also need to see this aspect of nitrogen fixation where we can genetically engineer organisms that have this particular ability. So we know that there are huge economic, environmental and agronomic benefits if we use biological nitrogen fixation in all the cropping systems. So all the living things require nitrogen, including plants, because it is a key element of their amino acids and the proteins. And we also know that there is a huge reservoir of nitrogen in the atmosphere, but this nitrogen is present in the form of nitrogen gas, which plants cannot use up or plants cannot convert into a protein or into their amino acid. So the gaseous nitrogen that is present in the atmosphere has to be first converted or fixed into a form that plants can use. And naturally, if we see, or the natural reserves of nitrogen in the soil are normally low. So unless we use nitrogen as fertilizers, chemical fertilizers, to increase the plant growth, the yield will not be much. So instead of using chemical fertilizers, an alternative method is by providing nitrogen to the plants in the form of nitrogen fixing organisms. So one method of you doing this is by providing or using nitrogen fixing bacteria in the soil as biofertilizers, or an important method is to, or important alternative is to develop transgenic plants which contain NIF genes in them, so that the problem of nitrogen fertilizer supplement in the crop plant is solved. So the plant itself is having this NIF gene. If it is having the NIF gene, it can fix nitrogen and it can provide nitrogen to itself from the gaseous nitrogen by fixing the gaseous nitrogen into ammonium. Now, this will also have beneficial effects of the economics and environment as well. The advantage here for us to genetically engineer organisms or plants which can fix nitrogen is that the structural genes which are found in the nitrogen fixing species are conservative in nature. So most of the organisms have similar sequences in their NIF genes or nitrogen fixing genes. And for this purpose, to engineer organisms or even plants which have this nitrogen fixing ability, TI based plasmid and cauliflower mosaic virus based promoter, CAM promoter, that is called cauliflower mosaic virus based promoter, have been used to transfer the NIF genes to non-legume plants. These are the two common plasmid mechanisms by which we have tried to transfer the nitrogen fixing genes into other plants. So let us see what are the different methods or what are the different possibilities by which we can genetically engineer biological nitrogen fixing ability and what are the challenges involved. So the first aspect is transfer of the nitrogen fixing genes to non-nitrogen fixing bacteria, which means, or it includes transfer of NIF genes, that is the nitrogen fixing genes from Klebsiella or Rhizobium, to other non-nitrogen fixing bacteria which are present in the soil, such as E. coli or Serratia. The advantage here is that these organisms, E. coli, Serratia, or any other organism, Bacillus, they are more hardy, they are more resistant to the environmental changes in the soil, and they can survive in the soil much better than some nitrogen fixers like Rhizobium. So if we transfer the NIF genes to these organisms will freely live in the soil, they will be able to survive any kind of harsh environmental conditions and provide nitrogen into the soil, or fix nitrogen and provided in the soil, making the soil rich in nitrogen. So one of the methods can be by transfer of NIF genes to non-nitrogen fixing bacteria. The second mechanism is by transfer of NIF genes to yeasts. Now here, NIF gene of Klebsiella has been transferred to Saccharomyces through a plasmid vector. This is also possible because yeasts are much more easier to culture and they are easier to manipulate in comparison to many other bacteria. The third possibility is not using the organism, directly transferring the NIF genes from nitrogen fixing organisms to the plants. This can include transfer of the NIF gene cluster of Klebsiella to protoplast of tobacco. This has been attempted, this has been tried. or NIF gene transfer of the rhizobium to protoplast of non-leguminous plants and to cereals, because as we know, rhizobium shows nitrogen fixation only in leguminous plants. So transferring the NIF gene cluster into non-leguminous plants or cereal crops can also help in increasing their nitrogen fixation ability. Many attempts have been made for this particular aspect, that is transfer of NIF gene to the plants to introduce NIF genes into the eukaryotic cells, but unlike prokaryotes, eukaryotes have monocystronic mRNAs and with a binding site at the 5' end. So if the NIF genes from prokaryotes are to be expressed in the eukaryotic cells or in the plant cells, it is necessary that we fuse the coding sequence of each gene to the promoter of eukaryote so that it produces a suitable ribosome binding site at the 5' end. These kind of challenges are the reasons why it is difficult to engineer plant cells with NIF gene cluster in them, but the studies are going on. The fourth aspect can be transfer of NOD genes. Now, NOD genes not only help in nodulation or formation of NOD nodules, they are also responsible for host specificity. So, for example, rhizobium faseoli will form nodule only in beans. But if the NOD gene of rhizobium leguminosarum, a different species, is transferred to this rhizobium faseoli, then faseoli can nodulate not only beans but also pea plants. So the same organism can be used to nodulate several different or to cause nodulation and nitrogen fixation in several different organisms. We don't have to use the specific species of rhizobium itself. We can use the same organism for multiple plants or multiple varieties of plants. So this is one reason why we can transfer NOD genes. And transfer of HUP genes. Now this is very important, because if we transfer HUP gene to a HUP minus strain of an organism that nodulates the roots, it will help in energy efficiency. So we know that nitrogenase activity is correlated with the hydrogenase activity, because the evolved hydrogen, there is hydrogen being evolved and this requires more energy. But we can save energy if this evolved hydrogen is converted into water, and this releases electrons. Now that process can be possible only if the organism has HUP genes. So there are several nitrogen fixing organisms which have NIF genes, which may have NOD genes, but they lack HUP genes. So we can transfer HUP genes to a HUP minus strain of nitrogen fixing organism so that the hydrogen that is being released is immediately converted into water and it is more efficient in the energy in comparison to a HUP minus strain. And many methods have been proposed to nodulate the roots of cereal crops such as wheat, but significant nitrogen fixation has not yet been achieved. This could be because there is internal colonization by the bacterium Azospirillum on the wheat plant inoculated with rhizobium leguminosarum or Azospirillum. But it has been seen that when we inoculate these plants with either rhizobium or Azospirillum, and we also apply 2,4-D, there are some lateral roots which become modified and they resemble the nodules of legumes. So these are called as paranodules, but to what extent paranodules are effective in nitrogen fixation is a possibility that has to be still evaluated. But there are chances of us nodulating even cereal crops using these organisms. Now coming to the challenges which are involved. So the main challenge, these are some of the challenges that I have listed out over here. The main challenges for us in genetic engineering, though it sounds very easy or very simple to perform, there are a lot of things that come in between when we are finally trying to see the nitrogen fixation and the yield of the plant. So control of multi-gene systems in plants is very difficult, and it can happen that what we do in the lab may not happen in the field. Also, there will be several overlapping sequences and their expression has to be controlled. It has to be made sure that the overlapping sequences are being expressed. Thirdly, release of any engineered organism into the environment is a challenge. It is a risk because we don't know how that organism will behave in the environment, whether it will revert back, whether it will cause any other damage. So this is a major risk which prevents us from using this technology in a far and wide basis. We also have another challenge, that is, it is not only the NIF gene cluster that has to be transferred, or it is not only the genetic engineering of NIF gene cluster. We need to remember that nitrogenase is an oxygen sensitive enzyme. So along with the NIF gene cluster, we need to also make sure that there is some protein or oxygen binding protein which has to be transferred so that the nitrogenase is not affected. So NIF gene cluster and any oxygen binding protein needs to be there to make sure that the nitrogenase in that particular organism is not hindered by the presence of oxygen. Also, there should be conditional suppression of ammonia assimilation by the microsymbiont or by the bacterium that we are using. So even though the bacterium that we engineer fixes a large amount of nitrogen, if it uses all of the ammonia that is being fixed, so nitrogen gets fixed to form ammonia. If the bacterium uses up all of that ammonia and has an excessive production of proteins, that is not going to help us. We need to make sure that there is supply or delivery of the nitrogen that has been fixed into ammonia. That ammonia needs to be delivered to the plants, or we have to ensure that that nitrogen does get delivered to the plant. So even though the organism or the symbiont, the microsymbiont, needs ammonia, it needs ammonia for its own proteins, we have to suppress the usage of ammonia or assimilation of ammonia by the microsymbiont so that more amount of ammonia is being transferred to the plant, which will help the yield of the plant. And lastly, we also need to make sure that there is supply of carbon from the root cells or from the plant to the endosymbionts. So when we are engineering an organism and that organism is able to form nodules or it is able to show nitrogen fixation, we need to remember that it is dependent on the plant for its carbon source or carbon supply. So the tests that we do or the studies that we do, the field trials that we do, should keep this fact in mind that we need to optimize even the supply of carbon from the plant to the endosymbiont. So these are some of the challenges which have been posed when we talk about genetic engineering of biological nitrogen fixation. But there are several tools that have been used. There are such as using broad host range plasmid libraries, or using DNA synthesis and assembly technology, or genetic circuits, that is basically promoters, ribosome binding sites, UTR, terminators, etc. So there have been several tools that have been employed to genetically manufacture or genetically engineer either an organism which has this ability, NIF gene and biological nitrogen fixation, or a plant itself which shows nitrogen fixation. So with that, we have come to the end of the unit on biological nitrogen fixation. Let us quickly review some questions with regard to this. So these are some questions that can be asked in your exam, or that you can use to revise your understanding of the topic. So in short answer, for 2 marks, they have several times asked these kind of questions, that is NIF gene or nitrogenase. They have asked the structure of nitrogenase. They can just give you a terminology like Azospirillum, Frankia, or Azotobacter, any organism which shows nitrogen fixation, or the very important protein component, that is leg hemoglobin. These are some of the questions that can be asked as a short answer variant. Coming to the descriptive or long answer questions, nitrogen fixation by rhizobium bacteria is a very common question for long answer, wherein you have to write the entire, if it is for a 15 mark question, you have to write the entire process, starting from biochemistry, genetics and mechanism, where you are showing the root nodulation, how the nodule is being formed. That also has to be written when it is asked with respect to rhizobium. Mechanism of biological nitrogen fixation is a very broad-ended question, where you have to write about the genetics and biochemistry of nitrogen fixation in general, and then write what are the different organisms that show. So we have non-symbionts as well as symbiotic nitrogen fixers. Types of biological nitrogen fixation is again similar to this question, because it will be asked for a long answer. You need to describe the genetics, biochemistry and the brief mechanism. You need not write the detailed mechanism of root nodulation when it is asked like this. Role of nodulin gene in nodule development. This is again a different way of asking the nodulation process in detail. So these are some of the questions that can be asked in your exam. I hope all of you have understood this unit, very important unit on biological nitrogen fixation. Thank you.